Watch this video with our virtual reality glasses for smartphone. Virtualvisor.com.
Our keynote speaker today says that VR will be the next billion people market opportunity. It's a bold claim. But then he's probably one of the most qualified experts to make such a statement. After all, Mark Papermaster is the Chief Technology Officer of AMD, a company that provides much of the computing power which underpins VR and AR experiences. So what will this era of immersive computing look like? And which technologies are on the starting line of this race to reality? Here's the man who knows. Please welcome Mark Papermaster.
Thank you very much. It's our pleasure to be at the 2016 IFA Trade Show. This event has been a harbinger of new technologies over the years. It's quite famous, actually. And so what a better place than to talk about this inflection point, this new category, as Jim's mentioned, which we find ourselves upon, that we find ourselves entering. And you know, that's the message that we want to share with you today. We want to share with you our vision, our perspective, and frankly, our proof points that we are in the midst of this change, of this new era. And so this new era, of course, is going to be exciting, and we are looking at the new applications that it will develop, the new markets, but you have to look at the world we're in today. When I look at what's led up to this, we're in a rapid change of technology. We see it in our everyday lives. So we expect that we interact with technology every day. It's quite seamless. We're connected. And in fact, technology is becoming actually anticipatory. I don't know about you, but every day if I leave the office, my Maps function, my app, opens up and it recognizes that I'm leaving the office and it tells me, here's your commute home, traffic looks good, or it might say it's snarled traffic, take an alternate route. So already, simple example, but we're seeing this change of technology impacting how we, as individuals, are interfacing with technology. And you know, I think it's instructive to look back a little bit. When you always want to look forward at these changes, you start by looking back, because we've been through, of course, a series of big, big changes. And you know, it starts with this change of technology, human interface with actually the radio. Think about before the radio. You weren't connected. There was no live connection of technology. And you know, the radio, it was an audio, it's through your ears, but established an emotional connection when suddenly the common household could be connected, could get information, could get entertainment. In fact, content started being created. You see many radio shows, and families would gather around the radio, and then of course radio became portable. So, you know, here was this clear inflection that started changing for the first time the immediacy in which technology could provide this communication, this link of emotions to technology. And then, of course, right here at the IFA convention in 1931, there's the first cathode ray television. It was shown right here. And it was a technology that took some time to then create that content mass market, because it needed to improve its quality and become more affordable. But of course, that's what happened, because technology is inexorable, it moves forward, and the TV became quite common. Networks were created. There was content. It became very personal for you to have that audio and that visual connection to technology in your daily lives. I don't know, I can think of so many events where I can tell you exactly where I was and who I was with when I saw that television image coming at me of such a historical event like 1960s, I'll date myself, 1969, Neil Armstrong walking on the moon, to even recently when, you know, some of the events that we've had in the news where we've had disruptive elements going on around us and we're glued to the TV and we're watching those real-time events. It's emotional, it's audio, it's visual, it pulls us in. And you think about it, what was the next step was obvious. Interactivity. Interactivity, and that's when computing became personal. Early 80s, that started the PC, it started with productivity. Spreadsheets and tools and such that would make some of your works that used to be very laborious, easier. It sped them up. But wait a minute. What about the World Wide Web? And what happened when that PC became connected and that World Wide Web brought information to your fingertips? Used to be, any type of research you do, obviously you go to the library. You spend days pouring through manuals, finding the information you need, or at work, you know, going through many, many texts. Well, once the advent of the PC and the World Wide Web, you don't think about it. It's interactive. You do queries, you pull what you need. And applications became developed. Social media, an entire new category, was created. So now, the technology-human interaction became even more of a connection to you. Audio-visual, interactive. So this progression has been moving quite rapidly. It's been almost continuous. When you step back, you see these changes. What happened here in this era was Moore's Law. The technology, of course, on these computers became smaller, less power, you know, more inexpensive at every turn, and allowed those PCs to become mobile, because you could take that experience with you. And in fact, it continued on into the point where it was actually portable. It was in the palm of your hand. And at first, again, I'll make that same connection to what we've seen in the history. It was a phone, and it was a PC type of capability, and that was very useful. And so the first phones, I was a very early adopter of the very first devices that had a PC and a phone combined. It was great, but it wasn't game-changing. It wasn't emotional to me. But what happened? Again, it's content. So app systems, app stores came about. Millions of applications came in that now, of course, are indelibly tied in your day-to-day life. I would bet most of you, if you left home in the morning and forgot your smartphone, you wouldn't go more than 30 meters down the road before you realize something is missing. It's like you forgot a piece of clothing that you didn't put on in the morning. It's that personal of a connection, that much tied in to your life. That's the difference technology, disruptive technology, can have in our lives, and we are indeed at an inflection point. And you know it's coming. You know it's coming because you know that you want a better experience. You always want a better experience. It's an insatiable demand. You can only look at examples of what we're driving into today's devices. You know, how we're aware, contextually aware we're at, how we're using voice recognition to ease the way in which we interface with technology. We want faster processing. We want better visuals, always better visuals. We want technology that understands us. And today, you know, we'll do whatever to create that better experience. So we'll go to the movies, we'll put on glasses for 3D to take a two-dimensional screen and give us that imaging of 3D. We know what we want. As always, the movies are looking ahead. They're helping us even visualize what we want. Look at Star Trek. Look at Minority Report. Look at Iron Man and those scenes in each of those movies where there's fundamental changes in how virtual and even augmented reality are used to bring in a greater experience into people's lives. We have imagined already the fundamental change that is coming upon us here. And in fact, we call this next inflection point the immersive era. In January 2016, so just earlier this year, Klaus Schwab, founder of the World Economic Forum, told us that we stand on the brink of a technological revolution. The speed of current breakthroughs have no historical precedent, and it's expanding at an exponential rate. That's from the leader looking at the world economy. It's very clear. That immersive era is defined. That next technological change in the immersive era is defined by a more seamless, more fluid interaction with technology. It surrounds us. It's smarter. It's leveraging deep learning to bring that smarts of information that's useful to us. Again, you're surrounded by sensors. You're overloaded with information every day. But what's useful to you? That's the change that we're seeing, is changing the way that we interface with technology and have it be more useful for us. This immersive era will first be ushered in by virtual reality. And then, as you heard earlier, there'll be augmented reality. There'll be mixed reality. But it is fundamentally changing how we'll have that connection with technology, how we'll interface with technology. And our view is that there's only one goal that we have. To have it be, as I said, seamless. It's a great start we have today, but it's not quite what I'll say is a true immersion. You can feel that you're transported to another area. I love it when I put on virtual reality and I can, you know, see like I'm in a different area that I've never visited before. It's amazing. I can play, I feel much more personally involved. But there's so much more to go in terms of driving to a true photorealism and pulling in all of your senses to where you're even having an even stronger emotional connection to this technology. And that's the progression you're going to see. You're going to see technology progress to give you that more seamless technology. Your interface will become easier and easier. It starts with the headsets of today, just like the examples I gave you of those disruptive technologies in the past. They improved rapidly. Well, that pace of innovation, of course, only speeds up each year that we go on. And so you will see more capability that will actually end up being woven into the fabric of our lives versus today, where we actually don a headset to be transported into different worlds. So no question, we are at the brink, we're at the start of having fundamental change of that connection that we have to technology, where we will see, hear, and sense. We will be truly immersed in how we interact with technology. And you might ask, why now? Right? It's been all of these other changes. We've been hearing about virtual and augmented reality for years. So why do we say now is the starting inflection point? Well, the answer is there truly is now a confluence of enablement. You have to have that critical mass, that enablement that allows an industry to take off. And we have that now. It's a combination of several factors. Of course, it's that the devices are all connected and that you have such a interaction that's already improved to the point where you have such accuracy of voice and gesture and interaction, even on a two-dimensional interface you have today. So that, of course, was the first element. That's a given. But you also had to have tremendous improvements in the compute and in the visualization capabilities. You know, when you look at supercomputers of 20 years ago, you can actually now get that kind of computation in a PC. So we have this enablement now, the kind of horsepower, the engine that we need to launch this new era, this new form of interaction. Thirdly, is of course speeding the content. And so with the advent of open standards and we've seen where you've had open source communities, application stores, and the programming techniques and the industry engagement that can spur that content development, well, all of that's there. All of that's there. You see it today across all the other media. And it'll all be leveraged. It'll all be leveraged going forward into this new era. But there was a last missing piece. The missing piece was, in fact, how to put all of that together to enable that immersive experience and how to make it affordable. You know, I started in the industry years ago and I had the opportunity to work on the first shuttle flight. And I'll never forget the simulation capabilities. It cost millions of dollars, but it created an environment of a virtual reality to actually simulate, to help train the astronauts. Well, think about what's happened in the last year. That type of enablement has dropped down into a consumer level of spending. It's down in the price range, and this is where we're very focused. We'll talk to you about this certainly in more detail in this keynote, but it was fundamental to have this last piece of enablement that could allow you to start that immersive experience and have it be affordable and leverage the technology that's been leading up to it. We are there. We are there. It's the start of a much improved experience. And I'll tell you what's incredibly exciting is that we're just beginning. We're just at the start. And we see our way of how to have that seamless, that totally immersive, lifelike experience. We know what it takes. And it takes a relentless pace of technology. You know, you look at the current displays, they're certainly well beyond, I had early HD displays, 1080p, and we're well beyond that now. You can buy your 4K displays. We're actually doubling that number of pixel capability. And of course, we're leveraging all of that as we shrink those screens and we leverage that in the head-mounted displays and we start this immersive interaction. But it's not at all lifelike yet. You know, as you see this path through photorealism, and you look at what it takes to get to what we call full presence, we see another 64x from those original 1080p screens of capability that we need. That's what mimics, that's what your eye is capable of. That mimics your human eye vision. So there's much more to go in terms of creating that capability. It's great today. I look at 4K displays. You can see grass moving in a field. You can see if an actor forgot to shave that day. You can see it all. But it's, you know still that you're watching a generated image. It's not lifelike. We need much more visualization to achieve that true presence from a visualization standpoint. And to render that capability, you need much more computer. I told you that we have the supercomputers of years back already today in the form of a PC. Well, we need, yet again, multiple fold entries. We need a petaflop, 1,000 teraflops of computing to truly render that lifelike experience where you cannot tell the difference between computer-generated image and reality. It's seamless. So that's where we're going. We're going from mimicking that sense we have today. We've taken the first steps. You saw it start with the flat screen displays. We're now starting that immersive era. But where we're going is to a truly immersive, what we call full presence environment, which is almost indistinguishable from where we are today. Imagine, if you will, that you can watch this IFA presentation from home, from your business, from your self-driving car, and feel like you were right here in the audience. It would be hard to even distinguish. Because again, you would see, you would hear, you would feel. That's the opportunity in front of us. And for us at AMD, it's clear we're technologists. So you don't have to think about all the numbers and the technology behind it. But when you understand that goal, you can see with the path that I've shown you that it will, in fact, just be a matter of time. I don't think anyone's going to bet if they said that somehow there was going to be a hard stop in technological progression. Every time someone's prognosticated that there was a barrier and that there would not be that next generation of microchip that could advance, that next generation of a display, all of these things that we require, there's always been an innovation breakthrough. And that's what we see for these immersive experiences. Both the high performance compute capability and the advanced visualization capability, it's clear how, in fact, we will achieve that. You need to have incredible capabilities to have that lifelike experience that I described. And in fact, you have to have frame refreshes and displays. It's actually 90 frames per second that you have to refresh that frame to have that experience. And so this inspires us at AMD. And we made a decision about 4 years ago that we saw where the industry was going, and we were going to invest. We were going to invest in high performance graphics and high performance compute. And it's so exciting this year that we've announced, for instance, our RX480, our Polaris family of graphics. It's a game changer. It brings, again, to the affordable price point for consumers, VR, virtual reality ready graphics processing capability, right down into that price point. It's about rendering those images, it's about rendering that huge number of pixels, and it's about bringing it in to the affordability point that will drive the content creation. So this is a huge piece of what we need. And I'll tell you, I want you to just look at this presentation that we have right here. It pops from the screen. It's the pixelation, the contrast ratios, letting the latest technology, it's amazing. This is a new line of processors we just announced at SIGGRAPH, Radeon Pro. And this presentation is being run from a Radeon W8000. And it's just amazing, that capability that it can bring images to life. And this was actually optimized for software at the local company called Ventus. Great partnership. So it's graphics driving that relentless pace, and it's the CPU that has to be paired with it. And we made a huge investment. Again, about 4 years ago, we started an entirely new CPU effort. We had let a gap develop on some of our CPU capabilities versus the competition. We set out to erase that, and that's exactly what we've done with the Zen processor. It had an incredible 40% improvement of instruction per clock. That's the performance metric that we have from the previous generation. Hardcore engineering, redesigning from scratch so that you can take those kind of workloads like VR. VR is going to soak up and leveraging this kind of processing capability because it's designed for a wider processing, taking those workloads like I just showed you and creating them, actually not only completing the computations much, much faster, but incredibly energy efficient. We had a 40% improvement in performance at the same energy of our previous microprocessor generation. That's phenomenal. I'm actually very pleased to share for the first time that in Berlin next week, AMD will be receiving an award from the Green Electronics Council. We had announced an initiative that a new processor is part of to reduce by 25x our energy consumption by the year 2020, starting from 2014. We're well on that path, and Zen is another step. So we're very appreciative of that recognition here in Berlin next week. So substantial GPU processing power that we have today, substantial CPU processor capability with our new Zen. But there's much more to go. There's much more to go. And so I have to tell you that what we're doing is making sure that we're doing this as a community, because all of that processing engine capability is only as good as we can bring the content with us. And so we've been very, very clear on how to get this done. We recognize the importance. We've chosen to take a different path than many of our competitors. We've chosen to go with an open approach. We took key elements of our graphics and our GPU software stack, and we made it open source. We have joined open standards approach with how we're developing that content enablement. Why are we doing that? We spent a ton of money on developing that capability. Why in the world would we put it out in this open environment? Very simple. It's the apps, it's the content that drives these new eras. Without it, nobody can win. The consumers can't win. It goes to the limited few. And when we open up the software stack, we go from having hundreds or thousands of programmers who are creating applications to many-fold more, because we make it available. We put it out there for the community to drive the betterment, to drive that content. It's a recognition that content is king, and it's our commitment to speed the development of applications. And I'll tell you, that's a perfect segue, actually, to our next segment. I'm going to step off for a few moments here, because I think it's really important for you to hear about what we're doing with content creation, because we're well on our way on this immersive area. And I'd like to introduce Roy Taylor, our Corporate VP of Content and Alliance Development, our BR expert. Roy, I'd love to hear from you. Thank you.
What an exciting time. What just a wonderful time to be alive and to work in our industry. VR is going to make a profound change to all of our lives. But the degree to which it makes that impact and the speed at which it takes that impact will be directly proportional to the content and the experiences that are produced for it. And so an immersive era can only be successful if you have a vibrant ecosystem developing for it. And we are passionate to our souls about people who create. Whether you're working on a new engine design, or you're a movie director, or you're a game creator, you're all creators to us. And we, this team at AMD, wants to help enable your project, your idea, to come to life. Because VR isn't going to be a big thing, it is going to be everything. There is no endeavor in which, as humans, we are engaged that will not at some point meet VR. This year, in April, the first medical procedure took place in VR. Also in April this year, the world's first court case was decided using VR. It will affect every single thing that we do. Because for 121 years, it was here in Europe, the Lumiere brothers invented cinema projection, with the excitingly named Factories, Workers Leaving a Factory, as the first movie. That was here. But for 121 years, we've been behind the window. Whether that window was a smartphone screen, or whether it's a movie screen, we're behind the window. And now, for the first time, we're stepping through to the other side. That will create exciting possibilities, but it will also create challenges. Movie directors, for example, can no longer control where the camera's facing. And so, we're going to have to solve some of the challenges that it presents to us. Now, we believe that VR today fits in three broad categories. The first is obvious and is known to everybody, which is games. And I think for a lot of people, when they think about VR, it's games that they think about. But there are two other categories we want to share with you today that we think are equally as important, if not more important. The first is what we call VR as a service. In China, it's called VR Plus. It's VR that's being used in industry to do design. It's being used in science and in education. It's being used in architecture. We believe that VR as a service, enterprise VR, is a vitally important category which will carry VR to success by itself. And the third category is what we call VRE, or VR entertainment pieces. Hollywood has wholeheartedly embraced VR. They're using VR today as marketing vehicles for traditional format movies. But in doing that, they've actually created a new medium. VRE, there's been more than 180 pieces of VRE already made. The Martian is one of the VR experiences. There's also one for Jurassic World. There was one for the movie Sleepy Hollow. More than 180 of these. And so we think that it deserves recognition for being the medium that it is. And the interesting thing is all three categories of VR are dramatically changing the pipeline, how VR is created. And this is very, very exciting, but also very, very challenging. The way we used to make content is no longer the same. New tools, new companies, and new techniques are emerging. In the case of 360 VR, we've seen Nokia launch a VR camera, 360 camera, the OZO. We've seen Jaunt, we've seen GoPro, we've seen companies like 360 Heroes who invented the first GoPro rigs. And these new camera systems are brand new. They didn't exist before. There are no standards on stitching. I'm going to talk about that a little bit more in a moment. Completely new. We're also seeing renderers. Renderers may not be familiar to many of you in the room, or many of you are watching the stream, but renderers were once used to create very, very high quality visual effects in the movie industry, and now being used in consumer electronics and in games to create beautiful assets. We're also seeing the introduction of light fields. Once light fields were the exclusive domain of projects at universities, and now light fields are going to being used to capture humans. We're seeing game engines no longer used for games. Interactive VR uses game engines, but very often they're not games, as I've just explained. And so we're seeing them not only change the way they're developed. Companies like Epic and Crytek and Unity are changing the way their game engines are designed to be used in VR. And we're seeing the tool chains, professional tools also change. Every major company, the Foundry, Autodesk, Avid, are introducing new tools to their products for VR. And then interestingly enough, the creators themselves are also changing. This year at the Game Developer Conference, there were a lot of people that aren't game developers. That was very curious to me. 18 months ago, I had not met a wonderful man called Chris Edwards, who's the CEO of a company called Third Floor. It is one of Hollywood's leading pre-visualization companies. I hadn't even really understood pre-visualization. But these companies in Hollywood are making VRE because they're the most familiar with game engines. So new companies, new techniques, and even finally when we get to platforms, of course you're familiar with PCs, of course you're familiar with consoles. But as I'm going to show you today, we're going to see the emergence of a brand new industry centered around location-based VR. So huge amounts of change. Now, from the point of view of AMD, what are we doing to help that change? If we're passionate, who are we being passionate with? Well, we're being passionate with people that make VR. We have today over 500 VR engagements. We're working with more than 500 game engagements, 251 games publishers, 1,500 game developers, 4,000 members of the Visual Effects Society, 100 movie studios, and 12 film schools. If I look tired, you'll forgive me, we've been busy. So huge amounts of engagement. Let me talk to you now more specifically about some of the things that we're doing to help VR, the new immersive area, come to pass. Mark Zuckerberg recently, here in Europe again, was in Rome, who said that in 10 years our social interactions will be in virtual reality. I believe Mark to be correct. But here's the interesting thing, if I'm going to interact with other people in VR, of course they need to look like them. In VR, of course, the wonderful thing is we're going to make some adjustments. In VR, I'll have a wonderful six-pack and very broad shoulders. But I will still want to look like me. So light fields and digital capture of humans is going to be an essential element of VR. Today, AMD is working with a company called Uncorporal out of New York. This lady here is an actress. She was captured in New York, and she was put into this apartment building, which is actually in a fictional VR world located in Alcatraz. What's exciting about this is, of course, she looks like her. So digital capture is going to be very, very important, and we're working very, very hard in this area and developing new techniques and new products for it. Now, I mentioned earlier about cameras. Great thing about cameras is the quality of the visuals they capture is superb. Modern cameras today are absolutely fantastic. But when you put lots of them together, you create a problem. Camera rigs today have up to 24 cameras at 8K resolution. Each of those images has to be stitched together. Now, if you can see the stitch, what happens is, at the moment of looking at the stitch, you've stopped looking at what the director wanted you to look at. The presence is lost. In the world of VR today, solving, creating perfect stitching is absolutely essential to creating wonderful VR. And there are no standards for it. It didn't exist so long ago. So as a result of that, I'm pleased to tell you that our engineers, our R&D, took a look at that, and we came up with something called Project Loom. Project Loom is a stitching solution which we're going to make available on GPU Open with source code that will allow camera manufacturers around the world to take the stitching software we have, use it together with our GPUs, and have absolutely faultless stitching. The reaction to this has been superb. The leading VR 360 camera company in Hollywood is called Radiant Images. We just announced a partnership with Radiant Images, and already some of the most talented 360 VR directors are using our Loom solution, including Lucas Wilson, very prolific, fantastic guy. So what I wanted to do today was tell you about some of the things that we're doing, but I also wanted to introduce you to some of the people we're working with. I thought that would be a fun thing to do. So I have some guests today. contribute to it. The first is a gentleman called Solomon Rogers. Solomon Rogers is a university professor who was so enamored with entertainment and VR that he set his own company up, and today he makes some of the most wonderful VR in the world. But to give you some background to Solomon, I thought we would run a short reel of some of his work to show you before we pass him on stage. So can we roll Solomon's work? Going, that we didn't want to restrict anybody's ability to make beautiful, beautiful art. Now, our render not only runs on our GPUs and our CPUs and our competitors, but it's also extraordinarily fast. Chaos Group, who makes a renderer called V-Ray, described it recently as being 2 times faster than anything from our competition. Because of this approach, our render is being rapidly developed. It's going to be in Autodesk Studio Max, and in Maya, it's going to be in Rhino, it's going to be in SolidWorks, and I'm very, very pleased to tell you, it's also going to be in Blender. Blender is a European company based out of Amsterdam that makes an immensely popular render. And a company called RenderStorm, based out of Calabasas in California, is offering rendering services, has already adopted it. And rendering, absolutely critical, really, really important thing that we have to do to make beautiful assets. But to tell you a little bit more about making beautiful assets, I want to talk to you next, my second guest. John McInnes was the writer of a game that some of you may have heard of, a little game called Call of Duty. He's also a wonderfully talented producer and director. His partner, Remington Scott, made a piece of special effects, which I believe everybody in this room has seen, Gollum. His partner did Gollum for Lord of the Rings. John is really wonderful friend with our company, but why don't we start by showing some of John's work. Can we run John's reel, please?
I think one of the beauties about something like this is you no longer have to imagine what it's like to be in somebody's shoes. You can actually be in somebody's shoes. And as I say, to put yourself at the front line of a company like this is a pretty incredible experience, and I think everybody can benefit from it.
All right, John, thank you so much for coming on.
All right, thank you so much.
I really appreciate your support. So we've talked about software so far, how NVIDIA has invented software for stitching for VR, and how NVIDIA has invented a rendering solution to create beautiful assets. But the byproduct of creating beautiful, beautiful assets is the larger the resolution, the larger the file size gets. And today, data sets for VR are extraordinarily large. And when we went to speak to the community and asked them what problems to solve, one of the problems they wanted to solve is, help me get my image in a way that I can edit it in real time. And then they asked, but in 8K. Because then high resolution headsets are coming very soon. Well, the problem with editing in 8K, it is very difficult to do, because file sizes are enormous. So we said, well, what if we did something completely different? Just completely, completely different. What if we took an SSD array and bypassed the PCI bus, bypassed the CPU, and mounted that SSD directly onto the GPU? What if we did that? What would happen? Well, first of all, you effectively create a professional graphics card with 1 terabyte of storage. But then you could do something really, really wonderful, and this is what we did. To try to render 8K resolution with any existing graphic solution from any vendor anywhere is inordinarily difficult. In fact, the best performance you can get is around 17 frames per second. That's not good enough. You can't edit that in real time. That's impossible. We demonstrated with the Radeon Pro SSG that you could edit 8K RAW at 90 frames a second. I am so thrilled about that because 8K images are stunningly, stunningly beautiful. And so we're shipping these out now. It's a great, great, great new product. So I'll talk to you about some software, talk to you a little bit about some hardware. My third guest today is representative of when all of the things that we do come together in one place. Siri Abrahamson is a director of international business at Associated Press. She's responsible for dealing with businesses, organizations, and governments. And today, she's talking to him about VR. Darrell Allen is also at Associated Press, and he is responsible for working on producing the VR content. So with that, let me give a very warm welcome, please, Siri and Darrell, to come on stage.
The Associated Press is the world's largest and oldest news agency. It is estimated that on any day, 1 billion people across the world see content that has come from the AP. But in a lot of ways, we're a 117-year-old startup, and that's because we're constantly having to try to find ways to reinvent ourselves, to find new ways to tell stories and to share news, to make sure that the stories we tell are relevant to the audiences of the day. And very often, technology is what helps us tell those stories better. And that's why we're so proud to be working with AMD and to be working with AMD Technologies, to try to constantly find those ways to tell stories better. And to talk about one of those stories, Darrell.
Thank you. So with AMD's technology, we were able to produce a fully CG 360 video on Alzheimer's disease. Alzheimer's disease is an immersive VR experience that allows the viewer to experience what it is to have the effects of Alzheimer's disease. We look forward to working with AMD on our next VR project and using the latest technology to do so. Thank you.
Guys, thank you so much. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. So, having got you all excited, I now have some slightly different tack to take. John Petty Research estimates that next year, between them, HTC, Oculus, and Sony will ship around 2.7 million units of their headsets. That's a good number. It's a great number. but I believe it's not a big enough number. And the reason for that is as follows. When Electronic Arts made Battlefield 4, the game, probably one of the most finest examples of modern games that there are, when they produced that game, it cost them approximately $100 million. It runs for a couple of hours, and so the production cost of that game is around $800,000. Electronic Arts sold more than 10 million units. A perfect example of a modern gaming franchise. Now let's talk a little bit about the film industry. The Martian cost $108 million to make, and with a running time of about 2 hours, about $770,000 per minute. And they sold more than $63 million tickets. Now here's the interesting thing, look at those two numbers, 63 million and more than 10 million, and then compare that to 2.7 million of headsets. The challenge we have today is if you are a creator and you have an idea to produce, to design something really, really wonderful, we now know that you want to have a production value certainly in excess of $500,000 and certainly probably nearer to $1 million if we're going to make the kind of content that we love so much today. The vaccines are expensive. So the issue is, however, is that your banker or your venture capital or your boss are going to ask you how many copies are you going to sell. And if the install base is only 2.3 million, that's not big enough. So we have a challenge. We must democratize VR. We must get VR into the hands of not 2.7 million people, of not 10 million people, but 100 million and 100 million and a billion people. And we need that to be absolutely real. Because until it's real, you won't get the production values that you want and the content that we know is so near. I can tell you that we are absolutely sincere about solving this problem. As Mark said, when we launched the RX480 graphics card, before we launched this card, a graphics card will run VR cost $350 from us or our competitor. We took the opportunity to smash that to pieces and give you a graphics card fully certified by HTC and fully certified by Oculus, which will run all VR, not at $350, but at $200. And we did that because we believe the opportunity in VR is so big that it's far bigger than a short-term interest in just selling the next generation of graphics cards. Now, once you do that, you can then do some wonderful things. I'm pleased to tell you that here in Germany, today, at IFA, CSL Computers have announced a computer, an Intel CPU, and it has this GPU, and it's for sale for €699. That price has never been seen in Europe before. So we're actually committed to this. We must democratize VR, we must get VR in more people's hands. But even so doing this, even if we sell as many as we can, I'm not sure we're still going to reach 100 million people fast enough. So we believe that the other key element, the other key part of virtual reality is going to be location-based VR. We need to put VR experiences at places where people go, whether that is a movie theater lobby, or whether that is a shopping mall or electronic dance festival. If we can put VR in places where people gather and give them tickets to try VR at a low price, more people will get access. This wonderful design location-based VR is from a Santa Monica-based company called Awesome Rocket Ship. In China, we're working with a company called Bachi Bachi Lin, another company called VRE, to put location-based VR in China. And we're here in Europe looking for people who want to produce location-based VR in Europe. And if you're watching this, you have an idea of location-based VR, please contact us. We want to talk to you. We want to help you. So, in conclusion, we are working in VR with the creators. We're working with the PC manufacturers. We're working with people who want to do location-based VR. We're working with cafes. We're working with every element of VR, whether it's VR games, or whether it's VR as a service, an enterprise VR, or whether it's VR and entertainment. I hope we've given you a small glimpse into some of the things that AMD is doing. Thank you for the chance to speak to you. And with that, I'd like to hand back to Mark. I'm sorry, Mark. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mark. Well, let's bring it to a close. You know, one of the things I want to reemphasize is how fast you're going to see this new era, this new immersive era dot in great products, life-changing products, and how we interface with technology come upon us. And I'll tell you, look at what you just saw. Think about what John McKenna says. He's leveraging game engines to rapidly create that kind of VR content you just saw. The industry knows from the smartphone era what it takes to have hardware, software, applications come together to solve real-world problems, to provide a different experience, to provide entertainment, to advance all of the fields that you just saw Roy describe and beyond. Because that's what disruptive technologies do. They challenge your thinking as to how you can apply it and how you can upend industries that never even thought it could be possible. And that is what it's about. It's about imagining the possibilities of being in a completely 360-degree true presence environment and conducting your interactions with people, your business, your entertainment in that future state. That's the possibility, and it's more than a possibility. That is what we are committed to accelerating. We have the products today to start us up that curve. We are well on the way on roadmaps that keep us advancing at every turn to be able to get that ultimate vision, that true presence as to how we interact in this immersive era. And I can tell you that with this shared vision, it's what inspires the company. We're a fraction of the size of our competitors. We are more agile, we're more innovative. AMD is back, and we're ready to partner with you to accelerate this new immersive era. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.